now I'm sudoing to root, and then you need to understand that for each and every software that is running on your PC or even on a remote server, there will be certain files which will control the properties that will define the runtime behavior. For example, if you install MP4 player on your PC, there is a typical installation and there is a custom installation. If it is typical installation, it will just install in a default location C program files. It will allocate default memory and it will register whatever is required to run your software with the default settings somewhere called properties files. If you customize those things, if you give a non-default path, or if you want to give more memory to it. For example, if you have installed torrent software, you might want to give as much bandwidth as possible for the downloads, but you want to throttle upload speed as low as possible. Instead of using defaults, you might have to customize a few settings, and those settings will be preserved on something called properties files. In Linux, for almost all the important softwares, the properties files will be under etc. If you go to etc and if you run ls-ltr and grep for ssh, again, for doing this, you need to be a root user or you should be a sudoer. Without those permissions, you will not be able to access this thing. If you use EC2 instances the way I am using, you will get full control and hence you can explore whatever you want. That's why I'm giving demos on EC2 instances. We can start very quickly. I will also cover how to create virtual machines to control the costs at a later point in time. But instead of getting into virtualization directly, I want to start from operating system. Then eventually we will get into virtualization. That being said, there is a SSH directory here. You can go to the directory and you can run ls-ltr. And there is a file called sshd-config. Our service is sshd, which is running all the time. So the service which is running is sshd. And from the client, we will run ssh to connect to the server through sshd. The command is ssh and the service on the remote server is sshd. So there is a file called sshd-config. We can go there, sshd-config, and you can search for password. You can see password authentication is set to no. Even though default is yes, it is set to no. That is the default behavior of EC2 instances. They will disable the password authentication. But typical machines, if you don't touch these files, if you just install sshd along with operating system or post-installation of operating system, the password authentication will be enabled by default. In this case, I am commenting it out. Whenever you change these properties, whatever process that is already running, that will not take that and change its behavior automatically for you. Whenever you change properties for any software, mostly there might be some exceptions where you can actually change the runtime behavior while the process is running. But in 99% of the scenarios, you have to restart the process. And a lot of guys will forget doing this, especially at their entry level. Make sure to remember whenever you change properties to control the runtime behavior, you have to restart the service. And if it is a typical production application, and if you have to change the runtime behavior, if you restart, then there will be impact to the end users. And hence, we will do it in a controlled manner. Anyway, we will talk about those things at a later point in time. For now, just remember that any properties file for any software, if it is updated to control the runtime behavior, we have to restart the service. Okay, in this case, we have to restart the service called sshd. There's a typo here. I have to say systemctl. Now, the sshd service is restarted. And now, if I exit from here and if I try to connect without the key, it will prompt for the password. You can see here, but I do not set the password, and hence whatever I give, it will fail. It will just say permission denied, please try again, because I haven't set the password for CentOS, which came as part of the setting up the environment itself, means as part of provisioning the EC2 instance on AWS itself. Now let me connect with the key again, and let me change the password of this user. Only root can specify username. So if I just have to change the password for the current user, I just have to type password. There is no current password for this, or I'm not aware of. In this case, what I have to do is I have to sudo to root, because AWS doesn't give the password for CentOS. It will only let us log in using passwordless login. Now, as we don't have idea about the password, either we can use sudo and then password command and then the username, or we can sudo to root and then run like this, password CentOS. And now I'm giving the password. I have to retype the password. Now password is changed. Now I'm exiting. Now I'm entering the command again. And now I can type, and it logged in successfully. Here I am trying to highlight the purpose of the properties file, which is nothing but etc sshd_config. That is the file file name, not the directory. So I cannot use cd. I have to either use view or vi to open the file directly. And this is what will control the properties of this are the ones which will control the runtime behavior. If you want to change the port number to some other value than 22, this is the one which you have to uncomment, and you can make it a different port than 22. Let me walk you through some of the important commands which we typically use. Permit root login. So if root is a very, very important user, he have complete control on the system. He can add users, he can delete users, he can mount storage and many other things. So permit root login, root is a very, very important user. And typically in most of the production servers, they do not log in as root from remote machines. If you don't want to permit to log in as root, you have to say permit root login to no. Let me show you the behavior of this very important argument. By default, it is yes. So if there is a password for root, people can log in. Let me show you. I came out and I'm changing the password for root now by running this passwd command. And I'm giving the password. Now I'm exiting from here. Now, instead of CentOS, I'm using root. It will prompt for the password, and I can give the password here, and boom, I logged in as root directly. So permit root login will let you to log in as root into the machine if you know the password. But even if you have the password, if you don't want people from outside world connect into the server using root, especially using SSH, then you have to disable that again by going to SSHD config and then changing it to no. Again, I changed the runtime behavior. If it has to be in effect, I have to restart the service once again. And I can do that using the systemctl command, and it is restarted now. Now, if I go back and try to log in as root, it will say, it will not complain directly, but even if I enter the right password, it will just fail. I'm just making sure that I enter the right password here. See here, it is saying permission denied. But still, it will be able to use CentOS without any issues. Only at root level, they have given this additional control where we administrators can control the external audience to log into the server as root directly using SSH. Now, the only way you can log into root is by logging in as a different user. And if you have sudo permissions, then he can log into root from the local machine using sudo. Or you can use something called console. Console is directly attached with the machine. It doesn't use SSH for the connection. It uses a different approach. Okay, either you have to use console or you have to log in as a different user who has sudo permissions, and then you can sudo to become root. Now let me go back to the SSHD config once again. So here we can actually control few things. How many max sessions a user can have? How many max retries can user try? For example, when I try to log in as root, it is saying invalid password. It will throw like that for 6 times and then it will give up. That is the purpose of that max auth tries. And authorized keys files, we will understand that once we get into passwordless login. For now, we are only talking about password login. And then few more things. We have already covered this password authentication. We disabled the no. By default, it is yes. And hence, it is letting us to login. And then if you want to use Kerberos for additional security, you might have to play with this. For now, it is out of context. Let's move on. We don't need to worry about Kerberos things. I'm not sure about this use palm, but that's fine. If you want to install a desktop and if you want to connect remotely to the desktop, then this X11 forwarding comes into picture. As of now, we don't have desktop and hence we don't need to worry too much about it. Let's move on to other properties. Let me check if I do miss any important property in this. No, I did not miss. That's it. So these are the properties which we need to worry about. And again, based upon what you are trying to do, you should be able to modify certain properties here. Typically, the port might be non-default. For extra security clusters, they might use some other port number. As I have mentioned earlier, each remote server, if you go to this picture, can have multiple IPs. One public IP for people from the external world can connect into this server. Second one, the local IP that it can interact with the servers and storage servers within that data center. Each of the enterprise servers might have multiple IP addresses. If you go to this EC2 instance, you can see here there is a public IP, and the public IP is this one, and there is a private IP also. As there are multiple IPs associated with this server, you can also control on what IP the service should be bound. In this case, if you go to this picture, SSHD is running. The port number to which it is bound is 22. You can also tell to which IP that service is bound. And if you go to here, if you say 0.0.0.0, that means the service is bound to all the IPs that are applicable to that server. Instead of this, if I remove and if I add this public IP, now I am adding public IP from here. And this is very, very important thing you need to keep in mind. This binding with IPs, you come across in many scenarios. And this is one of the troubleshooting nightmares for the newbies who just started their career as a DevOps engineer or Hadoop admin or whatever it is. For experienced people, they might know, but newbies might have some tough time to troubleshoot these issues. Now I have given my public IP in this. I didn't give the private IP. I am restarting the service, systemctl restart sshd. There is some typo in it. That's why it is failing. Let me see where it is, where there is typo. Let me comment this out just to make sure this is the one which is causing the issue. Yeah, I don't know where it got the typo. I think I cannot give this IP for whatever reason. There is no special characters here. Now let me say 0.0.0.0 and let me uncomment this and let me restart. Yeah, it is working, but if I give that public IP, it is not working for some reason. So I will troubleshoot the issue later, but the purpose of this is if you give the public IP here, if someone want to connect to the server using private IP, they will not be allowed. Okay, but I don't know why it is not working at this time. I will troubleshoot and probably I will cover at a later point in time if I get a solution. That being said, port number, listen address is one important thing. And we will talk about this listen address type of scenarios multiple times over a period of time. And then permit root login is very, very important thing. Typically, people will, system admins will disable this so that even if someone know the root password, they will not be able to log in to the server directly. And then the password login, enabling and disabling is one of the common property people will be working on. That's about using password login to connect to the remote machine.